Hello guys, till now you have understood what is price elasticity and what are its type. Let's now move forward to understanding how do we measure price elasticity. How through a numerical example you can understand how much is the price elasticity, or in fact is the good elastic or the good inelastic. So first basic method of measuring the price elasticity is the formula method. When you write symbolical elasticity, it is ED, means elasticity of demand. The basic formula for price elasticity of demand is given as delta Q upon delta P into P upon Q. Now you don't need to mug up this formula because it is simple. What is the base factor that is responsible for the price elasticity of demand? Yes, it is price. So whatever is the base will come in your base, means the denominator. So delta P is your base, and what is changing due to delta P is your quantity. So it is delta Q upon delta P, but it is a proportionate change as we saw yesterday. So it is P upon Q, where delta refers to change, P is your original price, and Q is your original quantity demanded. Okay, so whenever you are asked to calculate elasticity and the method is not given, you can definitely use the formula method. It is a very basic example, but then this is very important to, you know, put your theoretical conceptual knowledge into practical life. Let's say later we will discuss, in later session we will discuss about how to solve numericals. Right now I'll just give you a brief idea. Say for example, whatever equation we have, whatever prices we have, the entire calculation of this formula comes to 0.50. What does it indicate? That it is less than 1. If say for example, the elasticity of demand that you calculated through a numerical example comes to 0.50. So you know that this elasticity is less than 1, because 0.50 is obviously less than 1. So the commodity in the question has a inelastic demand. Okay, and if say for example the elasticity that you calculated comes to 3, so you know that 3 is greater than 1, means the elasticity of the given product in the question is greater than 1, means it is elastic demand. Okay, so whatever types we have studied, those are to understand the nature of products better. But basically when you are calculating through a numerical example, the elasticities are basically divided into either they are inelastic or they are elastic, means either they respond to change in price or they absolutely do not. So when doing the formula, let's take a quick revision here. What is the formula method for calculating elasticity of demand? You know that the base is change in price, so you will write delta P in the base, and due to delta P, what is changing? Delta Q is changing, but it is not an absolute value, it is always a relative value. So it is P upon Q, where P is your original price, Q is your original quantity. Okay, this is the first method. You better pause it and write this formula down. Okay, let's move forward to the next type of measurement of price elasticity. This is your arc elasticity. So whoever are appearing for CA and CS foundation, this method is very prominent in your syllabus also. So when you say arc elasticity, the elasticity of demand formula is Q2 minus Q1 upon P2 minus P1 into the opposite, P2 plus P1 upon Q2 plus Q1. This is nothing but an arithmetical formula, but again you know that the price is base and P2 is your new price, P1 is your original price. P2 and Q2 are your new or you are changed, price and quantity, and P1 and Q1 are your original, price and quantity. So you know that change in price is your base. So here also you will take P2 minus P1, and due to this P2 minus P1, what is changing is Q2 minus Q1, that is change in quantity into the opposite. Okay, it is just an arithmetical calculation. This is called as the arc elasticity method. Now you will have to remember these formulas, because a numerical example is given to you in the exam specifying only the method through which you have to calculate the price elasticity. Again, same, if the value that you get through this arithmetical calculation is less than 1, it means the demand is inelastic. If you get it positive, more than 1, it gets relatively elastic. Also, here is a small tip that whenever you are asked to calculate price elasticity and the change in price is given through a percentage, so you can directly calculate elasticity of demand as percentage delta Q upon percentage delta P. Then you don't have to multiply by P and Q. This is not there. Okay? Directly. And if say it is given in the absolute terms, it is given in the numerical terms, not in percentage term, in numbers, then the change in prices and change in quantity, you have to use the formula method. This is the proportionate calculation. Okay, proportionate always means that it is in percentage form, certain share form. Okay, now the next type is the midpoint formula. Now in midpoint formula, basically it is a geometrical representation of your various types of elasticity. Let's take a linear demand curve over here. If you take a linear demand curve, this is Q, and obviously you know that this is the price. So when looking at the graph, you know that here when the point touches the x-axis, the elasticity is what? Immediately go back to the types of price elasticity, and quickly you can remember that this is the point where the quantity does not change at all. Means this point where it touches the x-axis is nothing but the point where elasticity is zero. It is perfectly inelastic. And as opposed to that, when the point touches y-axis, the elasticity will be infinite. Now you know that in middle, where the elasticity should always be equal to 1, it is unitary elastic. And now without knowing this formula also, you can figure it out. What happens to elasticity when it moves from say 1 to 0? Or what happens when it moves from 1 to infinite? What will you do? How will you find this out? So please tell me that you have understood this. Say here, elasticity will either be relatively elastic or be relatively inelastic. When you say that your demand moves from 1 to 0, you know that it is less than 1. And when it moves from 1 to infinity, it is greater, it is increasing. So it is definitely more than 1. Okay, this is your midpoint formula. How you can find how many segments are in the upper section, how much are in the lower section. For example, let's say this is the point A, this is B, this is C, this is D, and this is E. Let's find out the elasticity at point say C. At point C, what is happening? The upper segments are 1 and 2, and the lower segments are also 1 and 2. So it is 2 by 2, that is the elasticity is 1. So now let's move a little downward and let's see at point D. What happens at point D? The upper segments are 1, 2, 3 and the lower segment is 1. So lower segment is 1 and upper segments are 3. So you will get this as something 0.33. If it is 0.33, it means it is obviously less than 1. Now on the opposite end, let's take B. What is happening in B? The lower segments are 1, 2, 3 and the upper segment is 1. So lower segments are 3, upper segment is 1, means the elasticity is 3, means it is definitely greater than 1. So to measure elasticity through your midpoint formula, what you have done here is you have measured the ratio of lower segments to upper segments. So it is lower segment upon upper segment. Now just to remember that this all is just a graphical representation, where this formula is not much used in practical sense, but it is just for the graphical representation. Okay, these are the types through which you can measure or calculate the price elasticity of demand. Now we will study what are the factors that basically affect the elasticity of demand. What are the factors that will determine whether the demand is going to be elastic or inelastic? There are various factors. We'll just study them one by one. These are the factors affecting the elasticity of demand. The first factor is nature of commodities. Now we have already studied that in nature of commodities, the commodities can either be necessity or say it can be comfort or it can be luxury. You talk about good being a necessity. You know that if there is a necessity product, those necessity products you cannot, you know, purchase less of them. Those goods are necessary for your survival. So obviously when the goods are necessity goods, then the demand has to be inelastic. Now when you talk about comforts, what are comforts? Generally comforts are the durable products like TV, air conditioner, such durable stuff. So the demand for comforts, the elasticity level for comforts is generally relatively lesser than the luxury. So the luxury and the comfort are relative subjects. Say for example, for a poor person, the TV can also be a luxury. But for a person earning a rational income, a very reasonable income every month, TV is not a luxury. It is just like today, everybody amongst us has TV in their home. It is not luxury. It is just a comfort. Okay, for people who cannot find water for their daily use, for them washing machine is obviously a luxury, but for us it is not luxury. So you can say basically that necessities have inelastic demand and comforts and luxury have elastic demand, but their level of elasticity may vary. Okay, the comforts are little less elastic than the luxuries. Got it? Moving to the next point is the availability of substitutes. Now you know what substitutes are. Substitutes are the alternate products, alternate goods that you can use. So if I say now you are demanding product A and it has huge substitutes, like it has, let's say, 5 substitutes, and the prices of that substitute increase, that product increase, what will happen? If the product A prices are increasing, you will obviously have 5 more choices to demand from. Means higher the substitutes, if there are more substitutes available for the given product, the elasticity is also greater. The level, the value of elasticity is greater because such products with available substitutes have high sensitivity to prices. Like if you are given an example, given an option to go and buy at relatively cheaper rate the same product, you will obviously go and buy the cheaper product, right? Because it gives you same level of satisfaction. The same thing applies here, that when you have majority of substitutes to your given product, the elasticity is always going to be high. So you can say the elasticity increases as there are more and more substitutes. If a good does not have a substitute, it might as well be a necessity. So it's going to be inelastic demand. Got it? Moving to the next point is the level of income. Now you are well aware with all this. What is the level of income? Like, can I say that if I have more income, then my demand is inelastic, and if I have less income, my demand is elastic? What is this? Here, income refers to the purchasing power. Okay, income refers to the purchasing power. The rich people with high level of income are generally not that much sensitive to prices. Even if the prices increase by, let's say, 10%, if a 10 rupees product goes to 11 rupees product, they might not change their demand for such small thing, because their purchasing power, their income is not restricted so much that a 10% increase in price will cause them to shift their demand. So the people, rich people with high level of income, their elasticity is low, means their demand is inelastic, as opposed to the poor people. If say you are earning 15,000 per month, and then your income shifts to 20,000, then that 5,000 is also a huge leap. So what are you going to do? You are obviously going to demand more of products, means your demand is going to change, means the level of elasticity is elastic. Okay, level of income refers to the purchasing power. Now I am saying level of prices. What do I mean by level of prices? Now when I say level of prices, I mean whether the goods are expensive or the goods are inexpensive. Now when I say expensive goods, what will happen? A change in price of these expensive goods and a change in price of inexpensive goods. These level of prices of a particular product affect the elasticity. If the goods are expensive, it means they are very sensitive to prices. Like we studied in relatively elastic demand, that a 10% change in price of durable products is increasing the demand by huge lot proportion. Means when the goods are expensive, they are very sensitive, because those goods might be a comfort or be a luxury. So when the prices drop, people are going to buy it because they have this sense of possessing some expensive products. So these are very sensitive to price, indicating that they have an elastic demand. And when you say inexpensive, you mean they have inelastic demand. Because say, for example, I'll tell you, if in case of inexpensive product, let's say necessities, those necessities, if the price increase or decrease, you are not going to react much. So the expensive products are very sensitive, hence the demand is elastic, and inexpensive products are not that much sensitive, so it has inelastic demand. There are also other factors or other combination of factors which might affect your elasticity, but again, all this is relative. The income level, the price level, the prices which I find high, you might not find high. Okay, or if I have more purchasing power today, it is not guaranteed that I might have this purchasing power tomorrow also. So these factors you have to understand. What is the nature of commodity? How do these nature of commodity fit to your demand? And how is the elasticity going to change? But here I'll give you just a basic note that when we are solving numerical examples and the product is given potato, then you will not judge it by the name, that potato. It is a hypothetical example. So potato might not be a necessity, it might also be a luxury, depending on what value you get. If you get it as 3, it means it is relatively elastic. But if you get prices less than one, means you have to determine that potato is inelastic. So whatever questions are given, rather than judging the name of the product, you judge the numerical value that you get. Okay, the other all remaining factors we will study tomorrow. Okay, so today basically we have seen what is price elasticity, what are the measures or what are the methods through which you will measure price elasticity, and some of the factors that affect the price elasticity of demand. Okay, thank you.